nested classes, and we have seen four types of nested classes. One is local, so inner class, basic inner classes, where a class is just inside the other class, and we have seen some of the properties of inner classes that that particular inner class can access the private data members of that class also, because obviously the particular class is belongs to that class, and it shows the aggregation property, containership basically. And we have seen how we can access, how we can create the object of inner class, and there is again the restriction that we should first create the object of outer class. And some explanation we have gone through for the inner classes, and some example was we have seen. And next we have discussed about local inner classes, classes that defined inside a method basically. So even in Java you can define a method, class inside a method also. And normally that those classes are very task specific. एंड उसका भी एग्जाम्पल देखा था. फॉर एग्जाम्पल डिस्प्ले मेथड के अंदर ही हमने एक इनर क्लास डिक्लेयर की थी. एंड अनलाइक प्रीवियस रेगुलर इनर क्लासेस, यू कैन नॉट क्रिएट ऑब्जेक्ट ऑफ इनर क्लास आउटसाइड द इनक्लोज क्लास, दैट इज आउटर क्लास. इवन इवन यू कैन नॉट क्रिएट ऑब्जेक्ट इनसाइड द यस सो inside the enclosed class, so you have to create object inside the method basically, because now it is local to that particular method, that is it is local to that particular display method in this example. So you have to create inside the method only. So since it is local inside a method, so it cannot be static, it cannot contain static fields, methods or classes. It cannot have the same name as an enclosing classes that we have already discussed in the previous class. It can access final variables but cannot access the local variables inside the methods. Next we have discussed about the anonymous inner classes, where we don't have name of the class. We generally create an anonymous inner class. Normally, when we want to write a short code or a specific single method that do a particular task, for that we define anonymous inner class. Since we don't have any name, so we are not writing class or some name of the class. So there are two ways to create it. One is either you write new and the enclosing class name, the bahar wali class hai, aapki outer class, uska naam. The arguments and the body of the class, or you can define as a new interface in the body of the class. So since there is no class name given, only the name of the interface or the superclass we can use for creating a anonymous inner class. So anonymous inner class also local, similar to the local inner classes that are declared without the name. This difference here. And since anonymous inner classes is actually within the method, so we generally or ye class declaration ke sath sath mein instantiation bhi hota hai, so we don't actually create object of that class outside explicitly in the method. So yehi likha hai, since anonymous inner class do not have a name, so you cannot use the new keyword in the usual way to create an instance of the class. Basically new keyword aapne class declaration ke sath mein use kar liya, so it actually declared and instantiated at the same time. Normally GUI string controls mein we see this type of use of anonymous inner classes. So one of the example was so an action listener is Java's supplied interface for the listening to button and or some other actions, or some other actions that you can define. So normally how you can write For the anomalous inner class, you can use new interface name and the body. So in this example, you can see from the object B dot, we are calling add action listener, and in the brackets of this methods, calling bracket of this, so argument list, in the argument list, actually we are defining a class and we are using new interface name action listener, and inside that numbers in a class, we are defining a method action perform that takes object of action event, reference of action event basically, and it is printing system out println. So whatever you want to print, like ouch. So like member classes, anomalous inner classes have full access to the fields and methods of the containing class. So there's another way. So instead of writing as a argument in the method called method, you can write inside the class also, inside the method also. So you can see in this example, let me increase this. So you can see here we have a method display. Inside the method we are creating a class. So in an anomalous class we start with a new keyword, so new object, that is the outermost class in Java. And so we are using the name of this that class, because we can use any super class name. So inherently our class has the inherits the object class, so we can use the new object name. We're defining two string method inside this, and that semicolon is of this, and your method ends here basically. Ends here, and this is for the class outer class. As also we have discussed, when this compiled, the three classes generates. One is the main class name, that is anomalous class dot class. One is outer class name, that is with the outer class name, that is outer dot class, and one class file for the anomalous inner class. Since we don't have any name, so it is integer number is there for the representing number of the anomalous inner classes. So if there is one anomalous inner class, then one, if there are two, so this number will be incremented for each anomalous inner class. The new keyword is followed by the name of the class that is specified, the type of object created for the from the anomalous inner class. So in the previous example, so the anomalous inner class was declared of the type of object class, and object implicitly have the two string method. So yeah, object have the two string method that actually whenever you create whenever you print an object, what it prints. चलो मैं क्वेश्चन पूछता हूँ. सो जब भी हम ऑब्जेक्ट किसी ऑब्जेक्ट को डायरेक्टली हम प्रिंट करते हैं, सो व्हाट इट प्रिंट्स ऑन द इंटरफेस ऑन द आउटपुट बेसिकली नॉट द इंटरफेस इन एनी जावा क्लास व्हेन यू प्रिंट द ऑब्जेक्ट व्हाट इट प्रिंट्स. Anyone else apart from Rishabh? Yes, so basically it prints hash code or the we call it object reference in the format of class name @ and hash code. So that implementation of this printing, yes, it calls two string method, and the implementation of two string method, implicit implementation of two string method prints that that output. So whenever you print the object, it implicitly calls the two string method that belongs to object class, and it prints the usual way that you define. However, if you want to print the object instance variable, then what you will do? मतलब आपका हैश कोड प्रिंट ना करे, जब भी आप डायरेक्ट ऑब्जेक्ट को सिस्टम आउट डॉट प्रिंट एलएन डायरेक्ट से ऑब्जेक्ट का नाम लिखो, तो ऑब्जेक्ट के जो प्रॉपर्टीज है उसको प्रिंट करे, ना कि ऑब्जेक्ट रेफरेंस को. तो क्या करोगे आप लोग फिर? Yes, you will override two string method in your class. Similarly, this particular example is basically what it is doing. It is creating an anonymous class, and inside that it is declaring the two string method, and it is just returning I am anonymous, the anonymous class. So the last. Okay, so this you can you can read it out like one second. So anonymous in a class is it cannot have a public private protected, it cannot be public private protected or static. It cannot have an explicit constructor because there is no name, because they have no name to give the constructor. It cannot either extend a class or extend a class or implement an interface, because what we are doing, we are creating an anonymous class as well as instantiating at the same time. So we cannot extend a class. Anonymous class type must be either a subclass of the named type or the implementation of the named interface. Normally when one instance of class is needed and the body of the class is very short, then we use the anonymous in a class. There is another class which is static member class. Now static member class, that is you defining the inner class static inside the enclosing class, but it is actually not very useful, because when we talk about static, then it is actually independent class, but somewhere it is written inside the other class basically. So static member class isn't really another class, but a top level class. So it is an independent class, but it happens to be written inside the other another class. So basically jo aggregation wala jo concept hai ya containership wala concept hai, that it not really define that concept, but still, it shows a strong relationship between the outer class and the static inner class. So for example, let's say in a hypothetical world, we are defining a class car, and jaise humne previous inner class ke liye humne example dekha tha ki the for example class tire or the class wheels are the part of the class car, so it can be declared as inner classes inside the outermost class. For a static inner class, assuming the class driver, now driver is itself an independent separate class. However, an object of driver class is always belongs to the car, so car always has a driver, so has a relationship is there. So if we talk about inheritance, then it is a relationship, but if we talk about aggregation or the containership or the inner classes, we have a has a relationship. A driver, a car has a driver, but obviously driver is not actually the part of it is a separate independent class, but since a car should have a driver, so it can be defined inside the car class also. So static member normally isn't really an inner class, but a top level class that happened to be written inside the another class. So that are not very useful, but yes, so there is a concept, so we should know this. So basically inner class defined as a static. And whenever we talk about static methods or static class, you should always know this, that it can only access the static data members of the outer class or static data members. Normally a static method can only access the static data member. So like static methods, a static nested class can only refer direct to the static members, only static members, not the local members or the instance variable of the closing class, even if those members are private. So why we do that? So nested classes are generally made static when they have a strong relationship with the enclosing class, but their existence is independent of an instance of enclosing class. Just like I told you about the car and driver. One of the thing that with the inner classes that you cannot instantiate the inner class. जब तक आपने बाहर वाली क्लास को इंस्टेंशिएट नहीं किया, लेकिन स्टैटिक क्योंकि ये इंडिपेंडेंट है फ्रॉम द आउटर क्लास, सो यू कैन इंस्टेंशिएट द स्टैटिक क्लास, नेस्टेड क्लास, इवन इफ यू हैव नॉट इंस्टेंशिएटेड द आउटर क्लास, बिकॉज़ सिंस इट इज स्टैटिक सो यू डोंट हैव टू क्रिएट द ऑब्जेक्ट ऑफ आउटर क्लास, यू कैन यूज द आउटर क्लास नेम ओनली. सो फॉर एग्जांपल यू कैन डायरेक्टली राइट आउटर क्लास नेम डॉट इनर क्लास नेम इज इक्वल टू न्यू आउटर क्लास नेम डॉट इनर क्लास. This is again the same again the example. So you're declaring a class, particular class static, and you're directly using the, you're creating the object of inner class. So as a static keyword is used in the trivial thing to understand, the in the previous example str, the string variable, is declared as a static. So it can be accessed by the static inner class, but I is not static, so it cannot be accessed. The variable I is not declared static, so it cannot be accessed in the class. So in summary, so we have discussed four classes: a member inner class, regular inner class, that a class declared inside the other class, ordinary, so it's like ordinary class just defined within the other, so it can have public static public private threaded access specifiers, has full access to the variable enclosing of the other class, anonymous in a class, normally short listeners claim use karte hain, use in only one place, and has full access to the variable of enclosing class. Static nested classes defined inside the other class but act as a outer class, so रखा अंदर है बट इट्स एक्स एज आउटर क्लास. लोकल इनर क्लासेस इट यूजुअली डिफाइंड विद इन अ मेथड कैन एक्सेस द फाइनल वेरिएबल इन द एनक्लोजिंग क्लास. सो दिस इज द टाइप ऑफ द इनर क्लासेस दैट आर देयर इन जावा. सो दिस इज द एंड ऑफ द नेस्टेड क्लासेस दैट आर देयर इन जावा. नाउ वी आर गोइंग टू, so from now onwards we'll with the example also, so because this was the basics of Java language, so now we'll start next topic. Let me share the screen of that. Okay, we'll just start it, and from the next lecture I'll take it slow from here, and we'll have the example codes also. So next topic is exception handling in Java, because after this class we will discuss about about container classes also, wrapper classes also. So collection classes, collections in Java. So we'll exception handling in Java. This is the topic for this lecture and the upcoming lectures. So basically, when you write code, so there may be chance of having errors in the code. So that basically three types of errors you have. One is syntax error. Normally, when you compile a program in any language, so if you done any syntax error, that then the compiler gives you the error and it reports the error and it show you that this particular line has the error or this error occurred in your program. Semantic or logical error. So normally your program compiled fine, but it is producing an unexpected output. So basically it is the logical error that you have done. So it is totally programmer's fault. From the logic point of view, there is a third category which is called runtime errors. So normally what happens, most often lead to abnormal termination of the program or even cause the system to crash. So at the time of compilation, it is working fine. Your program compiles fine and it creates class file, but when you run it, then due to some abnormal condition, abnormally, and sometime even stack overflow or other memory stack jab overflow aata hai to even cause the system to crash. So for that, to handle the runtime errors, we have exception handling in Java. So the exception handling Java is one of the powerful mechanism to handle the runtime errors, so that the normal flow of application can be maintained. Normally what happens in Java, exception is an event that disrupts the normal flow of the program, and it is an object which is thrown at runtime. So jab aapne program likha, compile sahi hua, aapne run kiya aur agar exception aayi, so even for exception we have a class in Java, because in Java everything is in the class, or for everything there is a class declared. So for runtime errors also we have a class hierarchy and we have a classes, different classes, and whenever exception is occur, an object of that class, particular class, is thrown at the runtime. Some of the common runtime errors that might occur, like dividing a number by zero, accessing an element that is out of the bound of an array. So that second one you can do in C or C++. In the C you can go outside the array. So assuming you have declared an array of size A5, that is an array of array containing five elements. But if you write like printf and pass, and you are printing, let's say, A6 or A7, there will be no error. There will be output, though it will be a garbage output, and it will depend on the memory location ko jisko access kiya hai wahan pe kya data hai already, so wo print kar dega, so it will be a garbage value. However, in Java you cannot do this. If you have declared an array of particular size, you cannot go outside the bound of array, and if you try to do so again, particular exception, an object will be thrown. So ek object throw kyunga aur aapka program abnormally terminate hoga. Output mein normally jo screen pe dikhta hai wo aapko us object ka description dikhta hai. Using negative value as an array size, unlike Python, you cannot do this in Java. Trying to store incompatible data elements, trying to convert from string data to a specific data value. Like, for example, if you define a string I, string I is equal to ABC, and if you try to convert it to integer value using method parseInt, then it will give you an error. File error, if you are opening a file that is in read mode, but it either it does not exist or there is no read permission, or you are opening a file that in write or update mode, which is, has only read only permission. So this is, these are the common errors that we usually do in Java. For example, so there are two things. One is exception and one is exception handling. So we are just discussing about the exceptions. So let's say we define a class, any usual class. So we don't have any mechanism of exception handling. And we have defined a main function. Inside the main function, there are two variables, A and B. And let's say A is 7 and B is 0. And if you try to print system.out.println, result is A divided by B. So divide by 0 is an arithmetic exception that is already defined inside the java.lang package as a package, and inside that package there is a class file called arithmetic exception dot class. So if there is any arithmetic exception is there, then it will show the throw the object of this class. So arithmetic exception, so yahan pe aapko dikhegi, us class ka naam zarur dikhega yahan pe. And error kya thi aapki, divide by 0 at error2.main for this particular line. So हुआ क्या कि आपकी इस लाइन पे आपका एक्सेप्शन आया, प्रोग्राम एबनॉर्मली टर्मिनेट हुआ और इस लाइन पे कभी नहीं पहुंचा. सो आउटपुट में ये लाइन आपको कभी प्रिंट नहीं होगी, प्रोग्राम रीच दिस लाइन. सो प्रोग्राम डज नॉट रीच हियर बिकॉज द एक्सेप्शन ऑकर्स इट जस्ट अबाउट दिस लाइन एंड द एक्सेप्शन वॉज अरिथमेटिक एक्सेप्शन. सो what we can do, we can handle this. So this was the handling approach of Java. So how Java handles implicitly the exceptions. So basically jab bhi koi exception aayegi, it will throw the object of that particular class and your program will be terminated abnormally. So uske baad ka code run nahi hoga, just jahan pe tha wahan tak run hoga aur uske baad exception aa jayegi. However, we can also explicitly handle the exceptions. One of the core advantages of exception handling is to maintain the normal flow of the exception. That is, for example, there are some statements, line statements in a program, and suppose line number 5 pe aapka exception aaya. So what we want to do, okay, exception aaya to theek hai, isko handle, yeah, we'll handle it separately, but statement 6, 7 or 8 should also be executed. So aapka normal flow disturb now. For that we can use the exception handling in Java. So normally what, so again going back to the same situation, what are the exceptions? The exception is represented of an error or error condition or a situation that is not expected result of a method. So they are already built in to the Java language and available to all the program code. And what exceptions do? Exception isolates the code that deal with the error condition from the regular program logic. So that are already there. Some of the common Java exception classes. One is arithmetic exception. One of the classes is array index out of bound exception. So if you try to print a array value outside the index of outside the size of the class, then it will print array index out of bound exception. It will throw an object of array index out. Array store exception, file not found exception, input output exception. Generally, input output failure is there. Null pointer exception. So whenever you are referring a null object, out of memory exception. Suppose your heap memory is filled due to some logical error, maybe an infinite loop or maybe an infinite recursion is there. So out of memory, the memory is filled. Stack overflow is also from the same side. So I think recursion so ye hona chahiye aapki. String index out of bound error exception. security exception when the applet tries to perform an action that is not allowed by the browser security setting. So these are the common Java exceptions are there. And now this is the important part. So all the exceptions will occur at the runtime. But all the exceptions are of two types. So basically, पहले मैं इसका वो दिखा दूँ आपको. हाँ, the hierarchy of the throwable class and the exceptions are this. So your top level class is object, and subclass is throwable, and all the errors and the exceptions are of this type. So there is an error class that extend the throwable class. There is an exception class. In the exception, we have runtime exceptions are there and some other exceptions there. So this is the broad hierarchy of throwable class. So all the exceptions are two type, checked and unchecked, where error is considered as a so all the type, even the errors that occurs, they are considered as unchecked exceptions. So two types of exceptions, one is checked and one is unchecked. Now in layman term, agar main aapko matlab batau, so in checked exceptions, if you have written a code that might give you a runtime exception, then, and if it belongs to checked exception type, then it's compiler's responsibility to give you a hint at the compile time. So compile time pe wo aapko it will stop you and it will ask you to handle this. So for checked exceptions, it is compiler responsibility, and compiler takes their responsibility and it gives you a hint by giving you an error that exceptions are not handled. So the classes that extend the throwable class accept the runtime exception. So runtime exception wali jo class hai, uske alawa jo classes hain jo those extend the throwable class and the error are known as checked exception. Checked exception matlab error nahi hai aapke program mein, but code likha hai aapne that might give you exception at the runtime, like input output exception ya SQL exceptions, then it's compiler responsibility and compiler checked that particular code and it gives you warning at the compile time, or checked at the compile time, that exception should be handled. Unchecked exceptions, now these are the this totally are the responsibility of programmers. So compiler won't check your code, whatever you have written, whether you have handled it or not. When it runs, if exception occurs, then the and then the exception object is thrown. So unchecked exceptions that compiler won't check, and it is not checked at the compile time, rather than they are checked at the runtime. So runtime pe dekhte hain. So whether you handle it or not, a compiler won't care. However, for the checked exception, compiler, if you have not handled it, now handle kaise karte hain wo आगे हम पढ़ेंगे कि हाउ वी हैंडल इट. बट इफ यू हैव नॉट हैंडल इट, नॉर्मली यू हैव रिटन अ कोड एंड लेट्स से इफ यू आर रीडिंग अ फाइल एंड इफ यू आर रीडिंग अ फाइल राइटिंग अ फाइल देयर माइट बी चांस ऑफ इनपुट आउटपुट एक्सेप्शन. फॉर एग्जांपल, आप एक फाइल रीड कर रहे हो जो डेस्कटॉप पे है, वो फाइल है, आपको दिख रही है फाइल है, तो देयर इज नो चांस ऑफ राइट. सब आपके जो एक्सेस जो मोड है वो भी allowed in, and you are reading that file using a Java program, but still compiler will give you warning at the compile time to handle the input output exception may occur, handle it. To handle this, it will give you error at the compile time. So whenever you are working with files in Java, you usually handle the exceptions explicitly. However, if the return code is like divide by zero and all, if you not handle it, the exception object will be thrown at the runtime and compiler won't care. वो रन टाइम पे अगर एक्सेप्शन होगा तो दिखा देगा. सो अगेन अ क्वेश्चन कि कितने लोगों को समझ में आया व्हाट इज चेक्ड एंड अनचेक्ड. चैट पे लिखो और मुझे सबसे आंसर चाहिए. मैं देखूंगा इसका कौन जाग रहा है कौन सो रहा है या किसने मोबाइल छोड़ के दूसरे रूम में चले गया या कहीं और है या मॉर्निंग टाइम में तो नाश्ता कर रहा हूँ ब्रेकफास्ट कर रहा हूँ. तो यस और नो में आंसर चाहिए. चेक्ड और अनचेक्ड समझ में आया कि नहीं. अगर नहीं आया तो आई विल रिपीट इट बट आई नीड आंसर फ्रॉम एवरीवन. ओके सो फॉर एग्जांपल वेयर एक्सेप्शन में ऑकर्स लाइक अरिथमेटिक एक्सेप्शन दैट वी ऑलरेडी डिस्कस दैट डिवाइड बाय जीरो. अगर आप लेट्स से यू आर प्रिंटिंग वैल्यू ऑफ ए देन द लाइन नंबर फोर इट विल हैव द एरर एंड व्हेन यू रन इट it will throw arithmetic exception divide by zero. So compile time पे कोई problem नहीं है. compile time में इसलिए problem नहीं है कि compiler won't care अगर वहाँ पे कुछ है भी तो. run time पे if there is an error it will be thrown at the run time. this is a hierarchy. so whatever there so throwable class के अंदर जितनी classes हैं except the सब क्लासेस ऑफ रन टाइम एक्सेप्शन. तो बेसिकली इस पोर्शन को छोड़ दो आप पैटर्न सेट वाले को. ऑल आर द चेक्ड एक्सेप्शन एंड इनसाइड द रन टाइम एक्सेप्शन ऑल आर द अनचेक्ड एक्सेप्शन. सो बेसिकली आपकी अरिथमेटिक एक्सेप्शन किसको एक्सटेंड कर रही होगी. इसकी सुपर क्लास कौन सी होगी. So runtime exception because it belongs to unchecked exceptions. So similarly the null pointer exception. So for example if you have defined a string s is equal and let's say you are assigning null. So again so s is object okay, of a string class and you are printing s dot length. So you are calling length method on this object and since it is null it is not pointing to any object. A string object, it will null pointer exception. Number format exception. So suppose you have defined a string s and you are assigning ABC, ABC string, and you want to convert this into an integer. So you can call the parseInt method and you can parse the string s and the integer form. Integer value should be in I, but a string is not in the number format, so it will give you number format exception. यहाँ पे मैं ये भी बताना चाहता हूँ कि Java में सारी चीज as a there is a class. So for the basic variables like basic data types like int, float, double, you have an char for character. You have a classes for each data type also. So for integer type you have an integer class also. For float there is a float. So If you are writing I integer full name with I is capital, so basically it is a integer class. So all the data types have a separate class also, and all these classes of data types are called wrapper classes. So क्योंकि क्लासेस हैं तो ऑब्वियसली उनके अंदर मेथड्स भी हैं. सो वन ऑफ द यूजफुल मेथड्स इज पास एंड. सो व्हेनेवर यू वांट टू कन्वर्ट अ स्ट्रिंग नंबर स्ट्रिंग नंबर स्ट्रिंग मींस अ नंबर व्हिच इज ट्रीटेड एज अ स्ट्रिंग. सो इफ आई राइट स्ट्रिंग एस इज इक्वल टू डबल कोट्स के अंदर मैंने लिखा लेट्स से 1 2 3. सो यू कैन यूज पास एंड मेथड ऑन दैट स्ट्रिंग ऑब्जेक्ट एंड दैट विल कन्वर्ट इनटू इंटीजर 1 2 3 123. For that you can use integer dot parseInt. Similarly, you have float dot parse float and other methods. So one of the useful method is parseInt that converts into the integer. However, since there is a number format error because string is actually a string, so there is no equivalent number. So you cannot parse it. Parsing means reading out every digit and trying to find out the meaning. So you have ABC doesn't have any integer values. Array index out of bound. As I've told you earlier, that if you have an array, let's say of size 5, and you are assigning value 50 to 810, then the array index out of bound exception will occur. That will give it error. So these are the 5 keywords that we use in Java to handle the exceptions. Try, catch, finally, throw, and throws. So this we will study in the next lecture with the examples also. So till now we have discussed about the exceptions. Now we'll discuss about how we handle it explicitly by the users. Thank you. I'm top kar raha hu.